First and second Stiefel Whitney classes of representations of symmetric groups. This is joint work with Steven Spallon. So first I will say something about the Stiefel Whitney classes of real representation. So for this talk I take G to be a finite group and let pi be a real representation of G. To this real representations, one can attach Stiefel-Whitney classes denoted by Wi pi, where pi varies from 0 to degree of, I varies from 0 to degree of the representation pi. And these are members of the cohomology groups Hi, G, with the ring Z mod 2Z. Now the action of G on this ring Z mod 2Z is trivial here. So I will not go into the technical definition of Stiefel-Whitney class of representation. Maybe one can see this book, Representations and Cohomology by David Benson, volume 2, for a technical definition. And since throughout this talk I will keep my ring is fixed Z mod 2Z, so I will just write Hig to denote Hig Z mod 2Z. Okay. So one for a representation, real representation pi of G, one can define this term W pi, which is sum of Wi pi. For I varying from 0 to the degree of the representation, and this element lies in the cohomology ring of G, the Z mod 2Z cohomology ring of G. I will mention one thing, that Wi of pi is 0 if I is greater than degree of the representation. Is it fine?
It's okay to me.
Hello?
Yeah, seems fine to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'll mention some basic properties. So W naught of pi, that is an element of the 0th cohomology group, that is equals to 1. This is the unit element in the ring, cohomology ring. And since the action of G on Z mod 2Z is trivial, we have the first cohomology group is isomorphic to Hom G plus minus 1. So one has W on of pi is equal to the determinant of the representation. If I take pi prime to be some other real representation of G, then I have W of pi plus pi prime is equal to W pi cup W pi prime. So this cup product is the product operation in the ring H star of G. And if I take a group homomorphism F from G prime to G, then the Stiefel-Whitney classes of this the representation of G prime is given by this formula, W of pi composite F is F star of W pi. Okay, so where F star is the induced map on the in the cohomology level. Okay, so in particular this property three, if I take the nth degree terms in both sides, I will get this identity. This is saying that the nth Stiefel-Whitney class of pi direct sum pi prime is summation of Wi pi cup W n minus I pi prime. Okay. So I will restrict to real representations only in this talk. So let's take V to be a real vector space. Now, there exists a group called PinV corresponding to this particular quadratic form. QV is minus mod V square, which is a negative definite quadratic form. So there is a way to define this pin group using Clifford algebra, and I am not going into that because that is not necessary for this talk. So just this information is enough that the spin V is a non-trivial topological double cover of OB, the orthogonal group, and let rho denote the covering map. So now I define what is called a spinorial representation. If I have an orthogonal representation pi of G, then it is called spinorial if there exists a lift, that is a homomorphism pi hat from G to pin V such that this diagram is commutative. So the reason why I'm mentioning this spinoriality is I will use this special property to calculate the first time, particularly the second Stephen-Whitney class of a representation. Okay, so let's to set the stage, let me give you some notation and definition. So sine will denote the usual sine character of the symmetric group, and a representation pi of SM is called chiral.
I would prefer some examples to proceed. If you could give some example which is not entirely trivial, simple but not entirely trivial, even a first
for a spinoriality
of, or even Stiefel-Whitney class spinoriality, anything, all these things that you have defined. Okay. So G is a finite group for you, right?
Yeah.
So I take some group like dihedral group or something.
Right. So right. For Stiefel-Whitney class, I think will come later in the slides. Mm. I will have some small examples. Mm. Now for spinoriality, I can quickly give you some example. So for example, a very trivial thing is like if you take SN and you take the sine representation, that is not spinorial, because for sine representation, this OB, this is a dimension one representation. So I'll have in the picture SN 2 plus minus 1, and since I am taking this minor negative definite quadratic form, the pin group becomes C4, the cyclic group of order 4. So it can be shown that there doesn't exist any homomorphism such that this diagram commutes.
So what happens if you take the positive form?
There also the sine actually the is aspinorial, means not spinorial. So it can be proved that it doesn't depend on the quadratic form you take. But for like convenience of the calculation, I have taken, means in my thesis, I have taken the negative definite quadratic form. But it is so, independent of the quadratic.
So you said that pin of V is something C4 or something.
Yeah.
Can you, so how can I see that? Or
so there is a way to construct this pin whistle. It's a long process, not long. Yeah. You have to do some steps. Like you have to calculate what is the Clifford algebra for this for degree one, means because I'm taking V to be a dimension one vector space, right? So Clifford algebra, and then you have to use that. There are two automorphisms on this Clifford algebra. Using that, one defines the pin group. So you have to actually calculate all those things.
Okay, so it is fairly non-trivial.
But it's generated by the unit vectors.
Yeah, it is generated by the unit vectors. I will refer you this book, Representations of Compact Lie Groups by Broecker and Dick. There, this example is done. Like for n equals to 1, that means the function of the vector space is 1.
Then, the authors like, again?
Hello?
Could you just name the authors again?
Yeah, it is Representations of Compact Lie Groups by Broecker and Dick. In the first chapter, there is a section called spinor groups, and there he has taken this particular quadratic form. That is why we also took this particular form and calculated.
So, what do you mean by cover is non-trivial? Like,
yeah, cover non-trivial means there is always a trivial cover, which is like you can take OV direct cross Z2. That is a 2 cover, right?
Okay.
So in other way, you can think of this as there is a short exact sequence 0 to Z2 to pin V to OV, right?
Right.
So it doesn't split. If it splits, then it's a trivial cover.
Okay.
So one more example. So in my paper, I have given one example of a non-trivial representation, which is spinorial, is like, I guess it is. So the representations of SN are parametrized by partitions, right? So you take the representation corresponding to, for n equals to 5, S5, for you take the representation V corresponding to the partition 3, 1, 1, for S5, that is like, that is spinorial. And that is the first non-trivial spinorial representation that we get. Is it okay? Like,
say, what was the representation? 3, 1, 1, huh?
3, 1, 1, yeah.
What's the dimension?
So the dimension is, okay, I have to just use the hook length formula.
Yeah. Six. And yeah, that you are saying is not spinorial, I see.
No, this is spinorial.
Oh, this is spinorial. Okay, this is spinorial. Okay.
So what happens for the, so for n equals to 4, 3 and 2, we only have the trivial representations are spinorial. All other representations, irreducible representations, are aspinorial. So this is the first non-trivial case that we get as spinorial. First non-trivial spinorial. Okay, shall I proceed?
Okay, what if you take a cyclic group?
Yeah, for cyclic group, if you take C2, it's okay. Because for C3 on...
What do you mean C2 is okay? What do you mean by that?
I'm saying that, first of all, you should have orthogonal representations. Then only you can talk about spinoriality, right? So in general, CN, the representations of CN, they are like one-dimensional representations, the irreducible ones. They are not orthogonal.
They are not even real, I suppose.
Yeah, they are not even real. So, but you can take the
two-dimensional.
Couple them up with the duals. So the pairs, they can become real representation, and you can talk about the spinoriality of those instances. So that there is a general description for that representation, and the result you can find in, I mean, my senior Rohit was working on this thing. I don't know whether it is published, but yeah, there is a criteria for inodality of those representations. I don't remember the formula right. Recall the formula right now. I can tell you later.
Okay.
And one more important thing is from using Stifel-Whitney class or simple observation, we can see that if the group has order, group is of odd order, then the representations are spinorial. The orthogonal representations are spinorial.
Okay, sir, could you repeat that again? Is that a general theorem or something?
So it comes as a corollary of some result that I will mention later. Like, if you take the group to be of odd order, then any orthogonal representation of that group is spinorial. So, for example, C3...
Something seems to be missing. I can always take... an odd order group mapping on to my group, right? I can just cross it with Z mod 3Z. Sorry.
But then it's even.
I can't do that. Yeah. Can't do that. Okay. So if you have an odd order group, and then it is spinorial, you're saying. Okay.
Yeah. Orthogonal representation.
Okay. I'm okay.
Okay, I'll go to the next slide. So here also I will define something and like state, give you some notations. So sign, as general as I told earlier, it denotes the usual sign character. Now a representation for a representation pi of SN, you can take its determinant. And so all the representations of SN are orthogonal. So the image will be either plus one or minus one. Like, so the point is, you take the determinant compus pi, it gives you a one dimensional representation of SN. And there are two one dimensional representations, namely sine and trivial. So if determinant pi is sine, we call it chiral. And if the determinant is trivial, then we call it achiral. So I'm taking these terms from the paper by Arvind, Amitansu, and Steven. It goes by the name, the determinant, the representations of SN with trivial determinant. Okay. So this is also a known fact to all of us that these transpositions, I plus one, is the transposition which swaps the integers I and I plus one. I denote them by small si. They generate the whole group SN. Okay. Now, since these si's are of order two, if I take the pi S1, the image of these si's under pi, they are diagonalizable with diagonal elements plus one and minus one. And I denote by g pi the multiplicity or the number of this number of minus one appearing in the matrix pi is one in the diagonal form of the matrix. Okay, and it can be easily seen that this g pi has a character value expression like this: dimension minus the character value at s one, the conjugacy class S1 with cycle type 2 divided by 2. And to see this, note that if you denote the this multiplicity of the eigenvalue of minus 1 by g pi, then the multiplicity of the eigenvalue 1 is just n, the dimension minus the chi pi 1 minus g pi. And that gives you this formula. Now, of course, you have determinant of pi of s1 is minus 1 to the power g pi, because g pi is the number of times minus 1 is appearing. And since this si, and one more thing is, this doesn't matter whether I take s1 or si, because all of them are conjugate in Sn. So determinant of pi of s1 is the, this quantity minus 1 to the power g pi, and it is clear that if g pi is even, then this representation pi is a chiral, means determinant of pi is the trivial character. Sorry, is this okay? Right. So similarly, I define this quantity h pi to be the multiplicity of the eigenvalue minus 1 for pi s1 s3. Note that s1 s3 is the element 1, 2 into 3, 4. So that is also a two order element. So again, like pi of s1, it will have a diagonal form with plus 1 and minus 1 in the diagonal entries, as the diagonal entries. So one more fact, which is also very simple, is this h pi, this quantity h pi is even. And this is also easy to see, because if you take zeta 4 to be a 4 cycle, say 1, 2, 3, 4. I take the 4 cycle to be 1, 2, 3, 4. Then the square of it is 1, 3, 2, 4. That will be conjugate to S1, S3, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2 into 3, 4. So the if I denote by M the multiplicity of the eigenvalue I for pi of zeta 4, then H pi will be 2M. Because I and minus I will have same multiplicity, and I and minus 1, minus I will give us the eigenvalue minus 1 for pi of s1. So shall I proceed?
Yeah.
Okay. So now I give you the lifting criteria. So a representation pi of Sn for n greater than equals to 4, for a representation pi of Sn, n greater than equals to 4, these conditions are equivalent. So represent the pi is binorial if and only if g pi, the multiplicity of the eigenvalue minus 1 for pi s1, is 0 or 3 mod 4, and h pi, that is the multiplicity of the eigenvalue minus 1 for the operator pi s1 s3, that is 0 mod 4. Now, putting the character value expressions for g pi and h pi, we obtain this, an equivalent criteria, which is chi pi of 1, that is dimension, minus chi pi at the cycle type 2 should be 0 or 6 mod 8, and the dimension should be equivalent, should be congruent to chi pi of the character value at the cycle type 2 mod 8. So we have criteria for spinoriality of a representation of Sn in terms of character values. And it's worth mentioning that if pi is spinorial, then it has two leads. And this is like one of the main theorem in our paper, which theorem 3.4 in particular. So note that for n is 2 and 3, this quantity doesn't make sense, this h pi, because it contains the character value at the cycle type 2. So it is enough to look at the quantity g pi. So for 2 and 3, a representation of Sn is spinorial if and only if g pi is 0 or 3 mod 4. So this first condition, first character value condition, will suffice. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I will move to Stiefel-Whitney classes again. So this result from the paper by Stiefel-Whitney classes of real representations of finite groups by Gunnar Vardena, Kahn and Thomas. This gives a relation between spinoriality and the second Stiefel-Whitney class of the representation. So it says, if pi be an orthogonal representation of a finite group G and W1 of pi is zero, that means determinant is one, then the representation is spinorial if and only if W2 of pi is zero. Second Stiefel-Whitney class should be zero. So this paper basically mentions the class in the second cohomology group, which corresponds to pink group in H2 of On, like the second cohomology of the orthogonal group. So from there this result comes, but for a different proof. You can see my thesis. I have tried to prove it in a simple way for finite group, of course. So we will use this result to say the similar thing for representations with W1 of pi non-zero. So we start with the representation of Sn. So let pi be a representation of Sn, of course, for n greater than equals to 4. Then pi is spinorial if and only if W2 of pi plus W1 pi cup W1 pi is 0. Okay, so to prove this, we use this common trick, which like we have used in our paper again and again. It's like you take the representation pi prime, which is pi direction sign, then see that this pi prime is a chiral, means it has determinant one. Okay, so for an a chiral representation, we have this criteria and use that to get a criterion for pi. So we just calculate W2 of pi prime. So this is from property three, as I mentioned in the second slide. So W2 of pi plus sine, and this decomposes like this. Now sine is a degree one representation, so W2 will become zero and this remains. So pi prime, W2 of pi prime is this. Now one simple result we use here is, one can easily show that for this representation pi prime, this pi prime is spinorial if and only pi is spinorial. This comes from the character value criteria, and we use that to say that W2, say this result that for a representation pi of Sn, pi is spinorial if and only if W2 pi is W1 pi, W1 cup W1 is zero.
So this trick is only for Sn, right? I mean this.
Yeah, so in general, we just replace sign by determinant. So this is a fact that we have proved in our paper, is for a finite group G, a representation, of course, real representation is spinorial if and only pi plus determinant pi is spinorial. And using that, we have this general result that an orthogonal representation pi of G is spinorial if and only W2 pi is W1 pi, cup W1 pi. So we'll use this for the rest of the talk. Shall I proceed or I'll stop here for some time?
Yeah, please proceed.
Okay. Okay, now consider the group of order two. So let C2 denote the cyclic group of order two. So we have the cohomology ring of C2 with respect to the Z mod 2Z ring is Z mod 2ZX. So it's a polynomial ring. where x is a degree one term, and in fact is x is equals to w1 of sine. Okay, so we want to calculate when a general representation pi of C2 is spinorial. So let's take a general form of representation like this. So pi is equals to so if I decompose, I will get all one dimensional representations. Let the trivial representation comes occurs m times, and the sine representation occurs n times. So from the third property of the Stifel-Whitney classes, I obtain this w pi equals to w sine cup w sine cup w sine n times, because this w this trivial, for the trivial one, w1 is also zero, all the wi's are zero, right? And what is w sine? Since it is one dimensional, it is just one, that is w0 of sine and w1 of sine, that is x. So this like occurs n times, so we have 1 plus x to the power n. Now I just take the binomial expansion, so I have this expression. So since I am interested in degree 1 and degree 2 terms, because I will calculate w1 and w2, I am taking the terms up to this, which is 1 plus nx plus n choose 2x square. So in particular, w1 of pi is nx and w2 of pi is n choose 2x square. Yes, square means it's just cup product. Okay, so remember that a representation is spinorial if and only if w2 pi is equals to w1 pi cup w1 pi. So this gives the criteria n square is congruent to n choose 2 mod 2. And this basically says that we should have n into n plus 1 by 2 is even, which is true if and only if n is 0 or 3 mod 4. So a representation pi of this form of C2 will be spinorial if the sine representation occurs n times, where n is 0 or 3 mod 4. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So having said that, let me just this is actually something obvious, but I have put a slide for it. Like I am trying to calculate the first Stifel-Whitney class. So some notation again, let pi n denote the standard permutation representation of SN. This means, by this I mean the representation via the permutation matrices. Like the image of the elements of SN are just the permutation matrices. Okay, so from this paper, I'm not trying to pronounce it because my French is not good. So from this paper by Sayre, we obtain that H1 of SN is Z mod 2Z for n greater than equals to 2, and the only non-zero element is W1 of sine, which is fairly clear, right? And since we had, I mentioned that the determinant of pi is minus 1 to the power g pi, the g pi was this quantity, chi pi 1 minus chi pi s1 by 2. So for a representation of SN, we have w1 of pi, which is determinant actually, is equals to g pi into w1 of sine. So it depends on the parity of g pi. Okay, so I'll go to the next slide. So remember this, I'll use this now. I should have put this in the next slide. So pi n denote the standard permutation representation of SN by the permutation matrices. So yeah, So these are the facts from that same paper. I say, first let us, so we have seen this, let me say this again. So since sine is a degree one representation, W2 is zero. So we obtain W2 of sine, direction sine is just W1 sub W1. So this particular element is important. So we name it as E cup. This lies inside H2 of SN. And H2 of SN is Z mod 2, Z2 plus Z2 for n greater than equals to 4. Therefore, there should be, and this cohomology groups are basically vector spaces, right? So we get from this paper by Sayre that these two elements, E cup means W1 sine, cup W1 sine, and W2 of πn. πn was the standard representation of SN via the permutation matrices. So the second Stifel-Whitney class of that representation and E cup generate this second cohomology group of SN. Okay.
What was πn?
Yeah, πn is the standard representation of SN. So you take the image as the permutation matrices. So for S1, say, you take, so it is like 0, 1, 1, 0, and rest of the diagonal entries are 1. So
like, by standard, you mean, sorry, say that again.
So maybe the standard name is not correct. So I just take the representation via the permutation matrices. So
defining representation.
Yeah. Like S1. So for example, the image of S1 will permute the first two, what to say, basis vectors. Is it okay? Okay, so in particular, take these two subgroups. These two subgroups of order 2, namely the subgroup generated by S1 and the subgroup generated by S1 and S3 of SN. And take the inclusions of these subgroups to SN as I1 and I2, right? So you will get the maps I1 star and I2 star in the cohomology level, right? So here is an isomorphism. So this phi, big phi, this is a map from H2 SN to H2 of S1, this is C2. And H2 of group generated by S1, S3, this is also C2. So the map is given by phi of alpha, where alpha is a cocycle in H2 SN, by I1 star alpha, comma I2 star alpha. This is an isomorphism for n greater than equals to 4. Okay, so to see, I'll give a sketch of the proof. So since both these groups are Z2, then phi will be a linear map between two dimensional Z2 vector spaces. And so it will be sufficient to show that the map is surjective. So we'll just construct two representations to show that their image like gives, so that their image is of rank 2. So let us denote by B1, the generator of this this cohomology group H2 of S1, and B2 be the generator of this cohomology group H2 of S1, S3. Now, consider the following cases. Okay. So, take this.
Sorry, Jyotirmoy, I'm not following.
Yeah.
Can we go to that?
Hello.
Could you repeat the argument why it is suffices to show that it is of rank 2?
So H2 of SN is Z2 plus Z2.
Mm-hmm.
And both these are Z2.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, like surjective means injective, and so, and these are all vector spaces because they are like the ring is Z2, which is a field of. So a linear map from Z2 plus Z2 to Z2. Is that okay?
It's okay. Please go on. Thank you.
Okay. So now consider the following cases. So take the representation phi 1. So first, this representation, again, it is coming into picture. So the representation of SN via permutation matrices. So I am taking its restriction to this particular subgroup generated by S1. So one can easily see that this will decompose in the following way. It will give one signed representation and n minus 1 copies of trivial representation. Right? And we call this, so remember that the number of times this signed representation is occurring is 1, which is not 0 or 3 mod 4. So maybe I will just go back to this slide. Yeah, so for a representation of C2 of this form, this is spinorial if and only if the number of times the signed representation is, the signed representation occurs is 0 or 3 mod 4. So here the number n is, the number of times signed representation is occurring is 1, which is not 0 or 3 mod 4. So this is aspinorial, it's not spinorial. And you can easily see that it has determinant, non-trivial determinant, so it is chiral. Therefore, we have W1 of phi1, phi1 is this restriction representation. This is not equals to W1 phi, W1 cup W1, because the equality would imply spinoriality, which is not true. And since this is chiral, the determinant is 1, so this both these elements are 1. So I have W2 of phi1 is not 1. And since the cohomology group is Z2, the only possibility is 0. Is this okay?
Yeah, looks okay to me.
Yeah. So.
Wait, what do you mean by W1 cup W1 is equal to 1? What is the 1 there?
It's the non-trivial element in the H2 of this S1.
Okay. Okay, some notation. Okay.
Yeah. So it is not 1. So, I mean, it has to be the trivial thing, 0. Therefore, recall that, where is it? Yeah, I had these maps I1 star and I2 star in the cohomology level. So I1 star of W1, phi1 should be 0 because it will map 0 to 0. Now consider the representation phi2. I mean, you just restrict this representation to the group S1, S3. This is also ordered 2 group. Now, this will decompose as sine plus sine. So the number of times sine is appearing is 2, which is again not 0 or 3 mod 4. So this will be again not spinorial or aspinorial. And but this has determinant trivial. So this is a chiral and a spinorial. So we must have W2 of phi 2 not equals to 0, because this equality would imply spinoriality. Therefore, this element, the image of this element under the big phi map, this will be 0, B2, where B2 is the generator for the H2 of S1. So B1 is the generator for H2 of S1, this group, and B2 is the generator for this group. So for this representation pi n, when I restrict it to this particular subgroup S1 generated by S1 and S1 is 3, the image of that gives me 0, B2. So image gives me 0, B2, right? And in a similar way, if I take the representation sine plus sine, this will give me the image as B1, 0. So it just shows that this map phi is surjective, which is enough to say that it is isomorphic. Is it okay, like for all?
Yeah, let's go on.
Okay. So now we state the main result. It's like for a representation pi, a real representation pi of Sn and n greater than equals to 4, we have W2 of pi is this W2 of pi can be written as this in terms of character values. So the two generators of H2 of Sn is E cup and W2 of pi n. So the coefficients can be written actually in terms of character values. That's the main point of the theorem. So quickly, I will see the proof. So again, I will first prove it for a chiral representations, that is the representations with determinant 1, then use the common trick to add sine and prove it for chiral. So since E cup and W2 of pi n form a basis of the second cohomology group, we have this expression for W2 of pi, where C1 and C2 are coefficients from Z2. Just take the image of this element under the map big phi, which I mentioned before. So it will give us C1 B1 and C2 B2. Remember that E cup was sine cup sine, so its image was B1, 0, and the image of W2 of pi n under phi was 0, B2. So we have this expression. And also see that W2 of the restriction map of pi to the S1, the group generated by small s1, is C1 B1. And the second Stifel-Whitney class of the restricted map to the group S1S3 generated by S1S3, small S1S3, is C2 B2. Now, C1 is 0 if and only if the restriction map to small S1 generated by the element small S1 is spinorial, and that implies that G pi is a multiple of 4, because G pi was the number of times sine was occurring, right? And if C2 is 0, that implies that the representation restricted to this particular group is spinorial. And since H pi was the multiplicity of the sine group, that implies H pi should be a multiple of 4. So we can set C1 to be G pi mod G pi by 2 mod 2, and we can take C pi C1 to be congruent to this particular quantity, and C2 to be congruent to H pi by 2 mod 2. So we obtain this expression. So without this bracket, this big bracket. So this comes from the second case. So this is the result for the achiral representation. Now for a chiral representation pi, we again take the representation pi plus sine, and since pi prime is achiral, we compute it's W2, which is this, and note that G pi prime is just G pi plus 1 because this extra 1 is coming from sine, whereas H pi prime will remain as H pi because H1 is 3 gives you the trivial thing. So just now we can use the formula for a chiral representation. The formula for the second Stifel-Whipple class for the achiral representation as before, and just some simple algebraic manipulation will give you this result. So, yeah. So this is the expression for the second Stifel-Whipple class in terms of character values. Maybe I will pause here for a moment and say that. Yeah, this is the main result. W2 of pi is, so this box appears because for chiral cases I'm getting GV minus 1 by 4 something. G pi.
So you have some results about counting the number of pi. For this, or
yeah, but I'm not presenting them here because that has nothing to do with. That uses the two-core tower theory.
Yeah.
Okay. So okay, just yeah. one thing to mention is, so. I forgot to mention this, that, yeah. So this, from this theorem, so in fact, from this only. So if I, it can be shown that if you take a group, finite group of odd order, then H2, in fact, HI, any ith cohomology group with the ring Z mod 2Z is zero. So any orthogonal representation of a finite group with odd order will have W1 pi is 0 and W2 also 0. Therefore, they are both achiral and spinordial. That means determinant is trivial and spinordial. Okay, so we're almost about to end. So here is one more thing. So this result is for n greater than equals to 4. So one question may be what happens for n 2 and 3. So for n 2 and 3, h2 of Sn is just h2 of the group generated by S1. This is isomorphic. So it is C2. So and the generator is E cup. Therefore, only the first expression in the theorem occurs in the expression for Stifel-Whipple. Okay, so this is something similar, but for a complete presentation, I must save your result. So this is also from my paper. So it's given that an orthogonal representation pi of n for n greater than equals to 4 is spinordial if and only if this quantity h pi is 0 mod 4. And The thing to note is that in this case, the lift is unit. Again, from the paper of Sayre, we obtained that the only non-zero element in this group H2 of n, which is Z mod 2Z, is W2 of pi n. Here pi n means pi n restricted to n, of course. So by a similar argument, we obtain that for an orthogonal representation of n, the second Stiefel-Whitney class will have this expression. Yeah. Note that this thing is always even, so the by four thing makes sense. Okay. So it's just almost about to end. So this is something for the product of symmetric groups. So if you have two representations, pi v and pi prime v prime, of Sn and Sn prime respectively, then we can take this external tensor product representation for the product group Sn cross Sn prime on this representation space V tensor V prime. And the determinant is like, it's like the determinant formula for tensor product of two matrices. It's determinant of pi to the power degree of the second representation into determinant of pi prime, the degree of the first representation. Therefore, we obtain this expression for the first Stiefel-Whitney class. And we have already mentioned the character value expression for all these terms. So one can read this first Stiefel-Whitney class from the character table. And similarly, one can obtain this second Stiefel-Whitney class of the tensor product as this. This comes from something called splitting principle, which is an exercise in this book by Miller and Stasher. And again, for all these quantities, degree pi and W2 of pi or pi prime, we have expressions in terms of character values. So one can also read or compute this second Stiefel-Whitney class from the character table. Okay, that's it. And here are some references. Yeah, I am done.
So, are there any questions? I think I asked. So, do you have a complete count for these things? You have a formula for counting the.
No, actually, I don't have. So, I computed only the number of a chiral spinorial representation. Odd dimensional a chiral spinorial. And for odd dimensional chiral spinorial, I am still stuck at the step, the basic step. It's like I have to classify all the odd representations which have f lambda equivalent to 1 mod 4 and f lambda 3 mod 4. So, okay.
But that's hard, I guess, yeah.
I think that is needed to get a complete count of odd representations only.
Okay, but we know that divisibility results of character values, that will imply that most representations will have trivial Stiefel-Whitney class.
Right. Yeah, I should have mentioned that. So, right.
Maybe you can just explain that briefly. I mean,
okay, so what is the expression? Yeah. So I have proved also, we have proved one result. So with Amritanshu and Steven, that most, so you take a fix a integer d and fix a cycle type mu say, then so mu is a partition of some integer k. So you can think of so you take the character value at the cycle types mu comma 1 n minus k of Sn. So maybe I'll repeat again. So you fix the integer d and a cycle type mu. Now consider the character values chi lambda at the cycle type mu comma 1 n minus k. So you add extra ones at the end to get a cycle type of n. So it can be shown that most of the character values are divisible by d. So asymptotically, most of the character values are divisible by cycle types are divisible by d. So using that, we can say that for most of the partitions, asymptotically for most of the partitions, W2 of pi is 0. In fact, W1 is also 0. So in a measure theoretic way, we can say for 100% partitions, we have 100% representations, we have W pi is 0. So 100% representations are scalar.
Okay, any more questions from anyone?